Section 2, a few stories about speed bringing on a winning or successful combination. Let's run through some famous applications of speed and some examples that you've probably lived through yourself. And we'll point out the speed applied, effective speed that is, and the BISS or BS that might have been applied. The assembly line, i.e. the Ford assembly line, is a great example of applying effective speed to attain the goal of producing cars quickly. Imagine if Henry Ford and five other mechanically minded blacksmiths or machinists tried to see how fast they could pour all the parts to the Model T from a coal furnace, then run over and build a car frame, then sprint over and assemble the engine block and its parts, grab their electronic gear and wire the whole vehicle. Then the six of them would quickly rivet on the body panels, upholster the seats, fire up and spray paint the whole thing, wrench on the wheels. That, of course, would look hectic, seeing those six people running around trying to see how many Model Ts they could produce in a day. Less than one, I'd guess. It would definitely be BS. And in fact, in 1903, Ford did only put out three cars in a day, compared to the hundreds in a day in 1913, when Ford completed the first continuously moving assembly line. Now that is ES, effective speed. Look at the goal, to produce as many cars as fast as possible. Ford looked at the big end goal and came up with the continuously moving assembly line. Ford did not run around a machine shop as fast as he could and put cars together. Remember learning to type? Imagine when you were in the hunt and stab mode to type on a keyboard. If you became super fast at punching keys with one, two, or even three fingers, you would be no match for a mediocre typist who is using all 10 fingers properly laid out over the keyboard. To just go faster with one or two fingers would be BS. This is an eloquent and very common example of my effective application of speed to the problems of business, life, and leisure. You can't just narrow your focus on hunting and stabbing, punching keys faster with one finger. You need to widen your focus and ask, what is the end result I'm looking for? Of course, it's to put words, sentences, and novels onto the printed page or computer screen, not to see how fast one finger can fly around the keyboard. There is, of course, an evolution here that we will see in some other examples coming up, and we'll see it right here. When you sat at a keyboard the very first time, if you covered up the keys with your fingers, you would not know which key was which. And to actually see what key you were hitting, there was a need to pull your whole hand away and stab with one finger. So the most effective, speedy way to type, upon first sitting there, was to hunt and stab. This method is not BS at that point in time. However, as you find you need to use a keyboard more and more, and are still using only one finger, while ignoring the possibility of using all 10 fingers, then that is BS. As I went from failing to climb the 3,000-foot sheer granite wall of El Capitan in Yosemite in 1988, to then doing it in a mere 3 days the following year, then doing it in 8 hours, and finally doing it in under 3 hours over a decade later, I did not just blindly climb faster each of those ascents. I learned the procedure, and I learned how to improve on the procedures. I was no more physically faster at age 38 when I climbed the route in under 3 hours than when I was 25 years of age and failed to climb the route. In fact, I might well have been able to climb faster at age 25, but at age 38, I was applying effective speed to the problem of getting up a 3,000-foot granite wall. Rather than applying dumb, fast climbing strength or hunt-and-stab method, I was looking at how to use my knowledge of all the aspects of more effectively climbing up this massive wall. To see some of the differences in how I am able to climb a 3,000-foot wall in 3 hours, while many competent teams take 3 days, I need to go over the process a little with you. When a team climbs a wall this long, they can only go as far as a rope length each time a member of the team leads up. Typically, this is around 100 feet. And given the height of El Cap, it's easy to see that it takes some 30 leads to get to the top. We call each of these rope lengths a pitch. At the end of each pitch, you need to anchor the rope so that the partner can follow up to you, clean up the gear you left behind, and hand it back to you for use on the next pitch. I've coached many people on ways to save time during these transitions at each pitch, in clinics and through my book on speed climbing. Many of these minute changes in the various tasks involved on each pitch only save a few minutes, and often the cynics argue that the tip won't help them get up El Cap very much faster. I then quickly point out that just a few tips that might save 12 minutes per pitch adds up to 360 minutes on a 32-pitch long route like El Capitan. That's 6 hours. 6 hours is the difference between getting to the top in the light of day or in the dark. Or it could be the difference of topping out in the beautiful early afternoon sunshine or not at all in the late afternoon thunderstorms. Remember now that every hour you are on the rock, you need more water and food for each person. That's more weight, and that in turn slows you down. There is a snowball effect of weight and more time to complete the route for every minute that you do not shave off your ascent time. It is a great balance or trade-off problem, that of taking more weight and having everything you need versus going light and topping out quick enough that you need very little. This, in fact, is a balancing problem I love working on.